This week on the Pressure Cast, Microsoft fights back against piracy, PlayStation 4 gets a preview program, and Nintendo's NX might not use discs. Plus, impressions of Volume, Pac-Man 256, Call of Duty Black Ops 3, Fallout Shelter, Zombie, and Fingered. It's Monday, August 24th, 2015. Everything happening in the world of video games is here, now, on the Pressure Cast. Biff.
What about now? It's time to rock with the biggity buck bumble. What about now? It's time to rock with the biggity buck bumble.
Bump to the bump, to the bump, to the bass. Bump to the bump, to the bumble. Bump to the bump, to the bump, to the bass. Bump to the bump, to the bumble. Bump to the bump, to the bump, to the bass. Bump to the bump, to the bumble. Bump to the bump, to the bump, to the bass. Bump to the bump, to the bumble. Bump to the boot, to the boot, to the boot, boot. Bump to the bass, to the bass, bass. Bump to the boot, to the boot, to the boot. Bump to the bass, to the bass, bass.
Hello, Pressure Pal. Welcome to the 92nd episode of the Pressure Cast. VideoGamesAreDumb.com's weekly video game news panic that posts every single Monday on the iTunes and the Stitcher and the YouTube and the TuneIn Radio and America's longest running independent newspaper at ExpressMilwaukee.com. Even though they keep telling me to say ShepherdExpress.com, I've decided not to. You don't even listen to the show. What are you going to do about it? Well, to a good start, my name is Colin Tanner, and I'm drinking two coffees. Okay, fine, ShepherdExpress.com. And across from me, the most beautiful man in video games.
The most hungover man in video games.
Steve likes gin cuff.
Yes. Jin doesn't like me too much right now, though.
And it's fresh from his most recent Ashley Madison hack, Justin Hambone Engelbart.
Qui-Gon Jin Cuff.
Fantastic, guys. Good. These are good things. I like video games. Don't we all?
That makes one of us.
Oh, God damn
hey,
it.
Hey, I kind of like them.
You know who else likes video games? The listeners. And sometimes those listeners like to contact us, and they can through an email address, pressurecast@gmail.com, or on Twitter, @pressurecastpod, or 954-947-7377. You can call or text, and we will read your messages on the air, or just leave a comment in this YouTube video if you're watching it on YouTube. Remember to rate us 5 stars on iTunes, but I don't use iTunes. I don't care. Get an iTunes account. Go over there and click 5 stars and write a review. That'd be nice. Justin, you're breathing like a mug in that microphone. Mm-hmm.
Didn't we tell you to hold your breath the entire podcast? Start now.
You're just going. I'm just giving. That's what I'm giving.
Yeah, it kind of, it's like you're about to ask me what I'm wearing.
Fantastic. Justin, you've got nothing to say that. But we did get an email, and this is the part of the show that I have titled, "Thank You for the Email." This week, it's "Thank You for the Email, Blake," as it is pretty much every week. Blake.
Wait, was it Blake again this week?
It's Blake again. Mm-hmm. He only has this to say. Note from Captain Know-It-All, the SNES game with the old man on the box art is Phalanx, dinks. Hashtag retro gaming.
Oh, the one I was thinking of actually last week was Axelay.
Oh, wow. Oh,
okay. Yeah. Phalanx, yeah, that makes sense, because I was thinking it was called, there's a game called like Phallus or something, but that's a totally different thing. That would be a very different game.
What was the shooter with the big naked Japanese guys?
Oh, that's Chouinichi, which I have as a PlayStation One classic.
Yeah.
Which it is not a classic, and I don't know how it
ended up. It's an okay game, but it's more of a gimmick. It's not entirely great.
It's really hard. Yeah. And not just the dicks, like the game itself, very, very difficult.
There's
it's
that stiff old competition. Man, the old man who's a tank, and he has the other head come out where his groin is.
Mm-hmm.
Game is fucked up.
I can only make it to the third level.
Yes, yeah, and you will never get any farther because say goodbye to this planet. It's time for the Earth Shattering Stars. Okay. Let's get to the biggest story of the week, Windows 10.
Okay, here it comes.
Here it comes, Windows 10. We all know it. We all love it. I didn't upgrade to Windows 10, but you did, Steve.
I did.
Justin, have you updated your MacBook to Windows 10 yet?
Can I do that?
Why not?
Sure. No, I'm not going to do it, I don't think.
You do you, Justin.
Boot camp that.
I got an iPhone 4. I'm not going to update anything.
Okay. Fantastic. We actually earlier this week learned that Microsoft is disabling pirated software on Windows 10 devices. This is not limited to PCs. This is also part of their phones. This was picked up from Elfer. Their report said Microsoft, this is part of the end user's license agreement for Windows 10, Microsoft may automatically check your version of the software and download software update or configure changes, including those that prevent you from accessing the services, playing counterfeit games, or using unauthorized hardware peripheral devices. This is kind of alarming, guys. I mean, don't get me wrong here. I want to state this first and foremost. Pirating games, like if a game comes out this Tuesday and you pirate it, you're a piece of trash. You are hurting the industry. You are hurting the people that are making those games. And there are people out there that are pirating independent games.
Oh,
shame on
that.
You.
That's mean.
I wish that I was a Battletoad so that I could run up and do the big boot move on
you. Which one would you be? Which Battletoad would
you I be? Would be Pimple.
That's one of the best.
That is one of, at least one of the three best.
It's
of
definitely
the
a top three.
Okay.
Now, here's where it gets kind of funny, because everybody says, well, wait a minute. How can you tell which ones are, you know?
What if you download the serial numbers?
I don't know. What do you mean?
I'm not going to talk about this.
Okay. What are you using? Salty? Salt mine? What are you using there?
Maybe. But okay. Yeah, if you get serial numbers, I mean, what do they double check?
Well, I think
then?
The problem is it's not currently 1998, so most games don't just use serial numbers anymore.
Well, if you don't want to play Marathon Infinity, fine by me.
Yeah,
but
if you don't want to play Jazz Jackrabbit.
Yeah, Jazz Jackrabbit. You know, here's the thing. It's no one's really sure how it determines which is real, which is fake. Where are the lines drawn? Do emulators count on here? What about ROMs? How do we know? Steve, you said you've already bumped into an incident with some of your legally owned games.
Yeah. So I definitely legally own The Sims 4 because I definitely think that Electronic Arts is a great company and they need my money because they're a small developer and, you know, they're not a giant monolithic company that has horrible business practices.
EA hurts. Thanks a lot.
Yeah. So I upgraded to Windows 10. And it was a little rocky at first. Like, it had trouble with, like, my video card drivers, my Blue Yeti Pro microphone. The drivers no longer work.
Yeah, now you understand why I was like, I'm not upgrading that fucking thing.
Yeah, but it's okay because I have a mixing board, so I just, like, plug it directly into that and then run that through the computer. Anyway, my copy of The Sims 4, it was like, not right when I first booted up, or, you know, Windows 10 for the first time, but a few days ago, Windows 10 was just like, hey, bro, just so you know, we did our usual scan thing last night, and, ooh, we saw that you had this pirated game, could be bad, so we just deleted it for you.
Could be bad. It's gone now.
Could be bad, yeah. We got rid of it.
I got a question for you. So, you know, I got my bin of games, right?
Yeah, your delicious bin of games.
I keep it right next to my computer. So if I get Windows 10... Is there going to be any problems there?
Well, that's like what we said. We don't really know about emulation or anything like that, or ISO files, because there are legitimate purposes to backing up your own software. And also, let's say, hypothetically, someone just breathed really hard in the microphone. I'm sorry, people.
I don't breathe.
Okay, good. So, if you were to, say, back up your copy of Jedi Knight, I don't know, you create an ISO for it because whatever, you don't want to hang onto the disk and you create like a text file where you're putting your serial keys
and
in there.
And then I broke the disk and I threw it away.
You broke the disk and threw it away. Is Windows going to come in and say, well, this isn't right and just get rid of it? We don't know. And even more so, it turns out that a lot of games that were running aging DRM, such as SafeDisk and SecureROM, are not compatible with Windows 10, whereas they were compatible with Windows 7 and Windows 8. Microsoft's Boris Schneider John had this to say. Everything that ran in Windows 7 should also run in Windows 10. False. This is false.
That's not true.
There are just two silly exceptions. Antivirus software and stuff that's deeply embedded into the system that needs updating. But the developers are already on it. And then there are old games on CD-ROM that have DRM. You know, the advantage of playing games on a PC is that you could play anything from any era. I mean, there are ways to get, for God's sakes, cassette games to run on Windows 7.
It's a pain in the ass, but you can do almost anything.
Bring it in. You could do it. You could make it possible. But unfortunately, Windows 10, this could always be updated later on. This is still a very early process. It was only released, what, 2 months ago?
Yeah.
A month ago?
Yeah, I think July 31st is when I upgraded, so.
Yesterday? You know, SafeDisk and SecureROM have said that they are not aware of any incompatibilities, and they also don't really have any plans to update. This is aging software that is not profitable any longer. which is their prerogative.
Yeah. Well, Colin, pardon my language, but that's a bunch of horse hockey because...
I can't believe this guy's saying
that right? We're going blue.
Coming into this room and saying that shit on this microphone.
But yeah, like when I upgraded Windows 10, one of the first things that popped up was there was an update for the Swindle, which literally just came out. And the update was, hey, sorry, this doesn't work on Windows 10. Like, we need to do a patch. So there's plenty of things right now that don't work. There's like a Steam forum where they're compiling a list of games and how they're running if they're running in Windows 10. And there's plenty of games that are not working right now. So,
well, and that's, you know, if for someone like me who's an internet celebrity at making amazing videos that everybody loves and no one dislikes, I can't risk if any of my encoding from, like, you know, using the bits and the RAM and the downloads and all that, I, you know, as an expert, I can't risk losing some of that stuff, especially because I use a lot of different hardware that, you know, I'm not really sure about the people that make it exactly. I use some very bizarre devices, and Windows 10 can't run things that are well known, recent, new, then I don't know if they're gonna be able to handle some of the things I'm gonna throw at it. And that's really alarming. On top of that, that it might say, hey, these drivers you've got for this thing, like I said, they're unknown developers for the most part. They go, we don't recognize this, get rid of it. You know, that's really terrifying. What about stuff like, you know, Google Code, where people are creating their own software? What if I actually do want to use, like, a GameCube controller on my PC? Because it says that they're also going to be taking care of devices that aren't recognized.
Mm-hmm.
That's terrifying.
Not good. Well, and even things like, okay, so my Blue Yeti microphone, the drivers don't work on Windows 10. That is, like, literally one of the most popular USB microphones that you can buy.
Every YouTube video I see, it's some jackass talking into some Bluetooth. Well, not
that's
just
right.
A jackass.
And you can go to youtube.com/optimismvaccine.
I use the Blue Yeti as well on my... I don't use the Snowball, though. I use just the Yeti on all my videos. So, alarming, to say the least.
Well, and then, slight tangent, but the best DRM and the most effective DRM of all time is, like, 1980s floppy disk stuff.
Yeah.
Because they'd always be like, flip to page 23 in the manual.
Yep.
So, there's games that you can't play unless you happen to know what's on page 23 in the manual.
Well, and there's some websites that archive all that stuff. You know, I was thinking about the other day, like, if you wanted to prevent kids from accessing websites and things like that, if you just ask them a simple question, is smoking cool?
Mm-hmm.
And if they answer no, then you don't let them in, because anyone that's 18 above knows that smoking is cool.
Yeah, it
well,
is.
And this,
that's my plan.
That's like Leisure Suit Larry. Like, the DRM for that was they would ask you questions that the developers felt only adults would know the answer to.
Yeah.
So you either had to be a really smart kid or an adult.
Well, we're not being treated like adults from Microsoft, and I honestly think that this is a major blow to Windows 10 from the enthusiast market, especially for the people that prefer to play games. But the sad bit is there's no real alternative. What are you going to do? Go to Linux? You're going to use that Steam OS? Like, there's nowhere else to go. Windows is the place to be, and I think a lot of people, like me, will just be sitting pretty on their Windows 7 devices and just staying there because it's just too much of a risk. Like, there's... That's what drives me nuts, is that it's too big for them to actually take these cases, you know, one at a time.
Mm-hmm.
It's an automatic system, and as we all know, automatic systems just simply aren't reliable at nuance, you know? And
look at YouTube's copyright content ID thing. Like, it's a disaster because there's no nuance, there's no human touch to it, there's nothing.
Yeah, it's really sad.
It's like communist Russia.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, that Boris guy from Microsoft might as well be Boris Yeltsin.
Boris Gates. Now let's talk about more piracy for the Earth-Centered Studies. So, we've learned a lot today about stealing and stealing digital things. But what about physical things? Well, we've all gone into a gas station and filled our trousers with peanut M&Ms and dashed out the door. But there's now more abstract physical items that you can now steal. Amiibos, in fact. We know about the Amiibos. They're for the Wii U and 3DS. They're these little figurines. You put them on your gamepad or whatever, and it activates content inside of the game. You can't steal that. That's an actual figure, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, until now, because there's the Amiikyu. The Amiikyu, which is, I guess, around $75 American. It's out of the UK, so it's £50 sterling. It requires you to use a near-field communication Android device to input information on this little disc-type thing. And you could say, oh, okay, I'm going to back up my Mario figurines. You can back up your figurines on here.
That's nice.
But you could also just go online if once this gets popular enough and just download other figurines. And it can hold up to 200 figurines.
Wow.
It already comes with data for 10 figurines on there. And then without purchasing any of those amiibos, just drop it right on the Wii U and boom, you can use all that information. Here's the thing. I'm pretty confident amiibos are a collector's market.
Yeah.
This has nothing to do with functionality. However, we're starting to get into this period where we're having a lot of near-field communication items being sold, such as the Skylanders and, you know, a bunch of other devices. Mm-hmm. There's a new thing, cards, I want to say, for Skylanders that you could obviously just print or steal. Are we actually entering into the era where these we're going to be stealing amiibos and other bits of data? Is this let me phrase this again. Once this takes hold, have they lost a portion of that market beyond the collector?
No, because I think the people that are going to use this, like this is something I would be interested in. Not that I would advocate piracy ever because that's bad and illegal. But I'm interested in it not only because I'm not interested in collecting amiibos, which I think is the main draw, like little kids and collectors just like them. But I don't like the process that Nintendo makes me go through to try and get things.
Yeah.
Like, I feel bad for the poor GameStop guy who gets a call like every 5 minutes. Do you have Rosalina?
Yes. Yeah. Click.
Yeah, exactly. So I don't want to go through that. I don't want to stand in line at midnight to get a, you know, a hunk of plastic so I can unlock a costume in Smash Brothers.
I do love some midnight plastics.
So I would say either, hey, Nintendo, make this shit more widely available. Or, you know, I mean, they're not going to take a big loss on this because I'm not the kind of person who's going to buy amiibos, but I would buy this just to have the content.
I just find it really interesting that, you know, as piracy goes on, it's starting to incorporate even these brand new and alternative methods of delivering downloadable content. Mm-hmm. I mean, essentially, they are portable physical DRM in a way to access that information. And this guy's just saying, no, here you go. We just solved this. And I'm just curious to see, because, and it sounds like it's not a big deal at first.
Mm-hmm.
I'm actually a little bit on the other side here and saying that this will hurt the market because I can imagine if you're just some, you know, you got a kid and they're just like, I want this toy, I want that toy. And be like, oh, wait, we can just get this. You can play as everybody. The kid's going to say yes. Now, mm-hmm. is the parent breaking the law? Certainly.
The parent is advocating piracy.
Well, yeah, but parents advocate piracy all the time. Parents will be like, oh, I don't know, I just let him watch his favorite cartoon show on YouTube on my iPhone, even though that's breaking the law. It's whatever is most convenient. The general market for this outside the collectors are children, and parents hate their children and want them to shut up, so they will probably buy them.
Parents are the problem.
Although I think, I think kids, the parents. Kids do like the physical item themselves. Like, they like the actual figurines.
They do.
Based on my limited conversations with five-year-olds, but...
Well, it's more on their end that's limited.
Yeah.
It really...
That's me.
It's cool.
I like amiibos. Yeah.
Well, I mean, you know, you bring me on the podcast because I can barely form coherent sentences.
Have you heard me so far?
The other thing that's interesting about it, too, is I wonder how Nintendo is going to pursue this legally, if they pursue it at all.
Oh.
Well, because stay with me here.
Oh, we're getting in the Steve car. Where are we going? I'm with you.
This is, you're not, it's not like, like, you know, those carts, the R6 carts, or what are they called?
Oh, the R4 carts.
Yeah, the R4 carts allegedly. For, like, DS, allegedly, that you could allegedly download ROMs and allegedly play, like, a million
games. And where
would
you get
DS.
One of those, allegedly? Because want to report them to the police.
It's called the World Wide Web, the net. It's a pretty hip happening place.
Which a reputable seller of those, I mean, allegedly.
You going on Silk Road to get these things?
Yeah, yes. You get on Silk Road, yeah. It's right next to the cocaine. But anyways, with those, you're like you're pirating the actual game software. Whereas this, you're not necessarily stealing anything.
Well,
you're using someone else's code to unlock on disk or part of the game, like content. You're just opening the gate. You're not necessarily stealing a whole product.
Colin, is this going to be a big scandal, though? Do you think it's going to be like a Watergate kind of scandal?
I legally speaking, I think that Nintendo does have, could sue very
easily.
Oh, I'm
sure they do. It's just like, it's different than piracy. It's
well,
just like,
it's not.
It's more like meddling.
No, because I remember when Napster was in trouble, they were comparing it to borrowing a CD from a friend.
Mm-hmm.
And in that case, they found that they didn't agree there because it was the act of copying that information that got them in trouble. Was that a Supreme Court case? I can't even remember.
Yeah,
was that a California case?
What I'm saying is, okay, so when I use an amiibo to unlock the content isn't stored on the amiibo. all I'm using is the amiibo is the key, and the gate is locked, and I use the key to gain access to the content. It's just like you know, like on disc DLC, things like that.
Agreed, but it's an actual purchase of that device that's going to give you that content. If you were to borrow it from a friend, that's one thing. But mm-hmm. when you are taking that information out, because you're actually being sold that key as well. You're borrowing the key. And there are legal reasons to use this AmiQ device, though, because mm-hmm. you remember you can only write one game at a time on an amiibo.
Which is annoying.
It is. So now you can have all of them on the same device and select one. So if you have your Smash Brothers Mario and your Mario Party Mario and your Zombie U Mario, there's no Zombie U Mario, but can you imagine?
I just think because it's a little murkier than some of the other stuff, I know Nintendo like defends their patents big time, but...
Do they?
Yeah, the R4 thing was around for a really long time before it got shut down. So I think this is going to be around for a while.
You want to talk Nintendo's patents, do you?
Yeah. Why is that another story?
That is going to be later on in the show.
Oh, damn.
But we do need to talk more about Nintendo's plans for the future. There are a number of analysts that are saying, this is a report, this is not confirmed, but okay, here's some backstory. Let's turn back the Wayback Machine. Boop. Okay. 18 months ago, Nintendo had a very bad financial report. They decided to hold a press conference. Miyamoto was there. Iwata was there. Mario was there. And you could tell he was on something. Like, Mario was not looking himself.
Is he taking mushrooms?
What they said is, here's our outline for what we're going to do. We're going to have vague ideas. Like, it was literally like circles and arrows pointing towards words. It was very strange. It was like a pie chart without purpose. And one of the ideas they brought up was the quality of life. They said, well, what's this going to mean? Is it going to be like a health monitor? Then we saw that patent that had something to do with like a sleep monitoring device that didn't require any connection to the body. It would just observe you while you slept. And it would be like a dock that you could put your iPhone in. It wasn't really clear what was going on there. Well, according to a number of these analysts, Nintendo's probably backing away from this now, mostly because they're embracing mobile devices. Who do we got here? Lewis Ward, he's an analyst, says, I do think Nintendo has always had an interest in blue ocean markets and healthcare. The intersection with their hardware and their software is something they viewed as an opportunity. Interesting. But he also added, it's supposed to be released in the United States by the end of March 2016, but I haven't heard anything. Michael Pachter chimed in as well, saying, I would say they're probably focused on... Can I do a Michael Pachter? I don't know.
Just say something that sounds smart but is completely wrong 6 months later.
I like Michael Pachter.
He's never right.
Okay, you got... we'll get into it some other time. I would say they're probably focused on just getting their mobile initiative working. That's far more important than quality of life. We knew that it was going to be a non-wearable and that it was going to be involved health some way. Is this Nintendo backing away from anything outside of games?
Well, you know, if I want to wear it, I'm going to wear it.
Okay.
I'm going to strap some Velcro on there. I'm going to put that puppy on.
Well, it would be a non-wearable, Justin, so they're not going to let you do
there's
that.
There's no Nintendo Fitbit for you.
You think Nintendo's going to shut me down?
Nintendo's going to come after you and close you down for Velcroing their device.
I don't know. I mean, if they haven't announced anything, that doesn't really mean anything because Nintendo's really good at hiding things, like a certain game that we're going to talk about very soon, probably.
What?
The Pokken tournament thing.
Oh, yeah. Okay, sure.
Yeah, like nobody saw that coming. That wasn't at E3 or anything. They're just like, oh, by the way, this is going to be out in the spring. So they just dropped shit on you.
It just makes you wonder what kind of why this existed in the first place. I know that Iwata, this stemmed from Iwata, who... is no longer with us, so maybe that he's gone now. They're kind of like, well, we don't know why we started this, and we don't know where it's going, and now that the guy that was really behind this is gone, let's just focus on mobile. That's where we want to focus. Honestly, mobile is a far more profitable area than trying to create some sort of Fitbit for, you know, Nintendo fans.
And it's not even
very unhealthy. Nintendo fans, big people.
If it happens, I wouldn't be surprised. If it doesn't, I'm not going to be surprised because Nintendo's always had an interest in like health accessories. The whole like vitality meter thing they were getting excited about. And then obviously Wii Fit was huge. But even going back to the NES days, like the Power Pad, like that was basically a health
initiative. It's a fantastic way to get your downstairs neighbors pissed the fuck off at you.
The Power Glove, too. I got a lot of exercise.
Okay. Well, I mean, I'm excited to see their mobile efforts, though. We still don't really know anything about that. Hopefully, we'll get some more information at Tokyo Game Show, which is going to be up in just a few weeks. No press conferences from anybody, though, including Sony, for the Tokyo Game Show, as far as I know.
Don't look into that.
What if you could download your Mario Maker levels to a phone app and then play them on the go?
I would love to be able to build my levels on a phone.
Oh, that'd be nice.
Nintendo? September 11th. You have to wait for that. And that's going to do it for the earth-shattering stars. Oh, my God. It feels like a lazy week, doesn't it? It just feels like we could just be sitting out at the patio and just drinking wine, guys.
I don't ever want to drink again. Right now.
Blunt Talk premiered this week. That was a big news story.
What's Blunt Talk?
It's a Patrick Stewart show on Stars. You just said Stars. That's what brought it up.
Oh, okay.
It's okay.
Patrick Stewart gets drunk. The show, right? That's basically it.
Basically.
Do you want to know why I started this show? Because I've got nothing going on.
I need to do another Reddit. Ask me anything. Yeah.
Do you think I'd let me on the next Star Trek movie? I'd like that. That's the only thing anybody knows me from.
I feel like you're about to say, like, heavens to Megatron.
Well, he's drunk. It's drunk Patrick Stewart. My favorite thing about wine is glug, 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 glug.
I'll tell you later.
The whole show is just him on the floor. It's one of those Andy Warhol drug movies.
You know, pretty much.
So what is that? New York something? I don't know. Go look at that movie. Andy Warhol directed it. It's insane.
New York Minute?
No, I don't think
so. Eugene Levy and the Olsen Twins?
That might be it. Sure. He was dead for a long time, but sure.
Eugene Levy and the Olsen Twins is going to be the name of my new band.
That's a great name for a band.
Oh, guys.
Sorry.
This show has been slow.
Got off topic here, yeah.
We need to pick it up. We need to get going. We need to
here it comes.
Time to do speedballs.
Here's
one.
It's the hype train. Fueled by video game buzz vibrations, we barrel towards video game satisfaction station on the hype train. This is where we cover all those upcoming games and hype you up. And we got so much news. And oh my God, it's going to be so much fun. We're going to have so much fun in this segment. Okay, let's calm down, everybody. Because Rainbow Six Siege, which was supposed to be out in October, has officially been delayed until December 1st. This is according to an Ubisoft blog. What they had to say is, we've decided to push this release date of Rainbow Six Siege to December 1st, 2015 for all regions. This wasn't an easy decision, but based on the feedback we've received and based on our own internal tests, we felt that there are adjustments and improvements we can make, including improving the co-op experience across all games, modes, weapons, and gadget balancing, as well as menu and interface navigation. We're taking a little more time to make these changes, and we think it's the right call. They're missing Black Friday. That's kind of a big deal, right?
That is. I mean, they're still hitting that Christmas window, which I think is important.
Yes.
And they're going to release it the day before my birthday, which is very important.
The old Christmas window where Santa Claus climbs through to drop off all the gifts.
And the Steve market. They're going to hit the Steve market.
Actually, Britney Spears was also born on December 2nd, so it's kind of the Britney Spears, Steve Cuff market, which I share with her. I'm gracious like that.
Excellent. Well, now we...
It's shitty, though. That's really shitty. You're going to lose a lot of sales.
Steve Federline market.
Fantastic. I'm really kind of concerned because Rainbow Six has lost a lot of steam since it was announced. Big deal at E3. 2014, and since then no one really talks about it anymore.
Yeah, I mean, before this story came out, I had forgotten that Rainbow Six was coming out.
I'm still super pumped for it.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, every time I see something going, I'm like, oh, this looks really fun, and then I just forget about it because there's not a lot of talk going on now.
They still have Tom Clancy's name on there?
Oh, yeah. I mean, that son of a bitch is all over their titles. I don't know. I at the end of the day, I'm really excited for it, but missing... It's not a death nail, you know, to miss Black Friday, but I think it does hurt you overall unless you have a very, very, very specific title like, say, a Far Cry. I mean, this is kind of Ubisoft's MO lately. That Far Cry missed Black Friday as well, didn't it? Or did it? No, that was Far Cry 3.
Yeah, Far Cry 3 did. That was like a really, like... low-key release, too. I don't think they had a lot of faith in Far Cry 3.
Was Just Cause 2 out in December...
possibly. That's, I mean, that's another series I could see them not giving a shit about, so that would make sense.
Well, that was, that's Square Enix.
Yeah, Square Enix, yeah.
Well, okay, I guess we'll have to see December 1st if this game is worth anything to anybody, or yeah, if it's going to be in the bargain bin.
I mean, unless you have a big name. Like, if you're a Call of Duty or a Grand Theft Auto, you can release whenever the hell you want, and people are still going to buy it. But Rainbow Six is a name, but it's not a huge name, and it's only a name to older people.
Like, well, what, which is why they had the Tom Clancy title.
Yeah,
in there.
Like, when did the first Rainbow Six come out? Like, 1996?
Sounds about right.
It came out
97.
I want to say 99.
99.
It was actually a little bit later because they did Rainbow Six 2, and then Rainbow Six 3 was out 2004.
Yeah, I just remember. I think I played it on like PlayStation, and it played like hot garbage on the PlayStation.
It was pretty good on 64. It was actually pretty good.
Good to know.
And not a great game, but a great experience. Much better on the PC. Let's move on, guys. Toot toot. There is a brand new PlayStation 4, and it got Darth Vader on it. Woo! Luke, I'm your father.
I can't breathe properly.
Hey, it's me, I'm your dad.
All those classic lines from the Star Wars movie.
When he's hanging, his hand fell off, and he's just like, oh, Dad, you're such a dick.
You knocked my hand off again.
Yeah, stop it, Daddy. Speaking of Daddy, the big daddy of PlayStation 4 is
Adam Sandler himself.
It's going to be getting a 1 TB console with the Darth Vader on there, as well as four, count them, four classic, in quotes, Star Wars games, including Super Star Wars, Star Wars Bounty Hunter, Star Wars Jedi Starfighter, and Star Wars Racer Revenge. According to Sony's Sid Suman, yes, you'll be able to buy the four games separately on the PlayStation Store. They'll have trophy support, too. Guys, do you care about any of those four games?
Where's Rogue Squadron?
No. Well, so when they say classic Star Wars games, they actually mean the ones that we could license for the cheapest, right?
I do like Racer. Racer's fun.
It's a game.
Okay.
I mean, is the Pod Racer one? Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, it's fine.
It's not the one with tiny, it's not the one with big heads or anything. It's an actual fun racer.
Super Bombat Racing?
Yeah, what was that?
I almost said Super Bombcast Racing. That's another video game podcast.
That's another podcast.
That's a good one.
Yeah, Jeff Gerstmann with, like, you know, chibi style Jeff Gerstmann.
We don't acknowledge them. They're our opponents in the podcasting world.
Yeah. How are we ever going to topple them? I mean, Super Star Wars is cool, but, like, Super Return of the Jedi is a way better game, I think.
I think,
I agree with that one.
I'm not kidding. I tried to play the Star Wars games for years, and I kept thinking, I'm not good enough, I'm not good enough, I'm not good enough. And finally realized, they're not good enough. Those games are too fucking hard.
Super hard. Well, and Super Star Wars, if I remember correctly, like, the very first level is this, like, Mode 7, like...
Nightmare.
Yeah, you're in, like, the land speeder going over Tatooine or whatever.
Oh, my
and
God.
And when I was a kid, I rented that game, like, 3 times, and I couldn't beat that part. Like, I never got past the first level. I thought it was just a shitty racing game that I couldn't beat.
I would rather play Star Wars on the NES. Mm. I would rather play, The Phantom Menace on the PS1.
Jesus Christ.
I do not like the Super series.
I would rather play Masters of Terra Cassi.
I would rather play the Indiana Jones game. I thought that was a better title.
You mean the point and click adventures? The LucasArts ones?
Lost City of Atlantis?
Oh, those are great.
That coffee has been there so long, it looks like motor oil.
What is the worst Star Wars
game? It tastes like motor oil.
Super Star Wars.
You really think so? That's the worst one?
Okay, that cannot be the worst.
I think it is. Like, there's a lot of bad ones, but they're so bad they're entertaining in some way. I love, Rogue Leader 2 or whatever that was.
Yeah.
Rogue Squadron?
No.
You talking about the Nintendo 64 one? Or?
No. God, what's it called? It's on the PS1. It's a FMV game. Allied Assault? No, I'm combining them.
Something. Oh, shit.
Rebel Assault 2, yeah. Because it's got the TIE
Fighters. It's a great game.
That go invisible. That game's great.
I think the worst one is actually the car combat game they released for the Dreamcast. It's just called, like, Star Wars Demolition Bros or something. And in the era where there was a clear blueprint on how to make a car combat game, it was just abysmal. Absolutely unplayable.
Still better than the movies. Doot doot! The PlayStation 4 is getting a preview program. This will enable people that opt into it to check out the brand new firmware updates before they're released, and also allow you to roll back to the previous stabilized update whenever you feel like it, the most recent released firmware update. The beta program begins on September 2nd, so if you want to do that, do it.
Is there a tangible benefit to me doing that?
Well, if you wanted to use, like, YouTube broadcast today, well, September 2nd, you could. By enabling yourself, you get to use the latest updates. So maybe it might have, I don't know, better controller connectivity.
So I gotta wait for these programs to update to use these.
Yeah.
Not worth it.
You don't have those features now? All right, whatever. It'll update when you're asleep, Justin. You're asleep.
You know what, Justin? I'm going to opt into it just to spite you.
Well, then I hope that you have fun waiting for your updates to upload.
You got that right.
That's a sick burn.
Toot toot! Phantasy Star Online 2 is coming to the PlayStation 4!
Yes.
So this is gonna be
in Japan. In Japan. It is a free-to-download game in Japan. There is still no word on a Western release, despite people really, really wanting that damn game to come over here.
So is it going to be like the Phantasy Star on Dreamcast?
Nah, it's more like an MMO. Like a real MMO. Mm. I know. That's more like the Phantasy Star Online is more like a Diablo clone, in a way. Because you want to raid with four other people.
Does PlayStation 4 have a keyboard? Or can I use, like, a USB keyboard with it?
You can use a USB keyboard on particular titles. I believe things like Final Fantasy 14 allow it.
Mouse too?
Yeah. As well as Bluetooth-enabled keyboard and mice. However, typing on the PlayStation 4 is a breeze because it uses the motion controls.
Oh.
So you just slide it around and just type in the words. It takes no time. It's the best on-screen keyboard ever.
So I won't have to retrofit my Dreamcast keyboard?
Oh my god, I actually have that. I want that GameCube keyboard, the one that had the whole controller. So you had like both analog sticks and,
that'd be nice.
And the keyboard right in the middle.
Get that thing and then put the microphone for Odama on top of it and you got a real setup there.
Play some Fight Night Round 2 on there.
Yeah, I remember playing that game with you, Justin, and I beat you, even though you used Little Mac. Cheap motherfucker.
You were way too good at that game.
I will teach you guys how to be good at Fight Night. How's that?
I was amazing at Fight Night.
Uh-oh. It's on!
Toot toot!
Toot 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 toot!
The Xbox August update is adding a brand new feature for Windows 10. You can now stream your Xbox One to Windows 10, which is already a feature. However, now it can be up to 1080p, 60 frames a second. Oh boy. If you own an Xbox One, would you ever use this feature?
I don't think so. I want the opposite to be a thing that I can do. Like, I like PC the idea of having my PC in my office and then streaming it to my television in the living room. I don't like, why would I want to? I don't understand.
Because they want you to buy an Xbox. Buy an Xbox,
they're doing really. No, I just got my PlayStation 4.
Steve, you got a birthday coming up.
Yeah. Jingle bells. Toot toot! Evolution Studios, the soon-to-be-closed-down Evolution Studios.
R.I.P.
That's my guess. That's not an actual story. Says they're going to be supporting Drive Club for another year. According to Jamie Brayshaw, your input always plays a huge part in powering our monthly updates, too. Just like you have done for the very start. And we're just... Oh, my God. I can't read any quotes. What he says is some dumbass thing like, hey... Please give us ideas for what you want for Drive Club, and we would
tell us how to make video game.
Yeah, here's a tip. Maybe make a different game.
We don't know what people like.
I have a few questions about that because you probably have more of an informed idea of this game than I do.
Mm.
Do people actually play Drive Club? Like, is that a thing?
Yeah, very weird, lonely people from England.
Okay, so it does have an audience, and has the game gotten significantly better since its disastrous?
It has gotten better.
Okay.
The features have expanded out. The game has not gotten better. There are definitely more features, and now you can have your Drive Club, but the game still plays bad. It's not fun.
Is it better than the Ubisoft what's it called, Car Cry or whatever?
Oh,
Car Cry.
God, the Crew.
Yeah, the Crew. Yeah.
I would actually give it to the Crew. I think that a little bit better design, even though the game is not.
Can we
great.
Trademark Car Cry? Can we do that?
Oh my God, the Crew would just do these weird glitches where like your car would out of nowhere just start flying forward through walls.
Yeah, I mean that's part of the reason why I love. Modern Ubisoft is just because I enjoy watching their games glitch out, not playing them.
Toot toot! Phil Spencer has said that original Xbox games, yes, the system that was released in 2001, might be backwards compatible on the Xbox One. What the heck? What the heck? Well, here's what he had to say. One person said, hey, I know this is a silly question, but would you consider doing this? And he says, I don't think it's silly. I asked the backwards compatibility team this question a lot. Need to finish 360 BC for now. Actually, I have been waiting on BC on the original Xbox, which would be amazing. The Peter Molyneux title. Make it happen, Phil. That's all I can say.
I can't wait to play Critical Depth again.
That is your game. That is the game you keep referencing.
What God's name is Critical? Is it like a sub game?
It's like a Twisted Metal underwater game.
It's like a submarine that looks like a shark. It's got like shark teeth on it.
Yeah, they painted some shark teeth on it.
Okay.
It looks great. You shoot like missiles and stuff. Targeting system doesn't work very well, but For some reason, I just want to play it again and see if it's as great as I remember it.
When was the last time you played Critical Death?
Probably in the late 90s.
Why don't you just keep
your... You kept me the late 90s.
Early 2000s.
That's probably right. Just keep your memories pure. Don't play it again. Oh, but yeah, I'd like to play like Panzer Dragoon Orta or something like that. That'd be fun.
Crimson Skies, motherfuckers.
The problem is, though, if they used the same emulation that they used on the Xbox 360 for playing original Xbox games...
Oh, no.
Yeah, that would be bad because it basically doesn't work.
What about Bleem?
That was for Dreamcast games. For PlayStation 1 games on Dreamcast. It's different, and PC.
Why do I keep bringing up the same things?
I don't know. Toot toot! Nintendo has patented a console that does not utilize a disk drive. This is according to NeoGAT. They uncovered this. This is all rumor and speculation, but I'm willing to bet it's 100% true, and everyone believed this following sentence. This is from the patent. The example system is not provided with an optical disk drive for reading out a program and or data from an optical disk. An example system includes an internal hard disk drive storing a program and or data, a communication unit transferring, receiving a program and or data via a network, and a processor executing a program stored in the hard disk drive to perform gaming processing. Guys, what do you think about that? A system without a disk drive? Is that crazy?
No, I mean, it makes sense. We're getting to the point where systems aren't going to have disk drives, and all the crying about how much you love physical media, that's not going to change that.
I love physical
media. I love physical media, too.
And I love being a turtle.
You know what? You can't stop the future.
You can still buy your Amiibos, fellas.
Yeah.
The other thing is, too, is just because it doesn't have a disk drive doesn't mean that there's not going to be some sort of, like, physical format, because, like, real brick-and-mortar retail and you know, like, wrapping shit for Christmas, you're not going to wrap, like, a piece of paper that's like, yo, dog, I downloaded a game for you. There's going to be something. So whether it's just like DRM via a little, you know, like SD card or something like that.
Or is this, there was that rumor that the Xbox One was going to have two SKUs, one with the disk drive and one without. Maybe this is just one version of that system. That would
also
be much more affordable.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we are in the age where people are more comfortable using Rokus and, you know, Google Chrome and salad bars. So they, you know, anybody
I think video game fans more so than any other medium that I can think of outside of maybe book people. Really, really, really love their, like, physical media.
I hate books.
You know...
Toot toot! Pokken.
That's why we burn them.
Pokemon Tournament? Anybody? A fighting game starring a Pokemon? Well, that's already been in Japanese arcades for, you know, a little bit now. But it's been confirmed that it will be coming to the Wii U this spring.
So wait, are all the Pokemon real short in this game? Do you have to be ducking to kick them if you're using a non-Pokemon character?
There's a bunch of different Pokemon. There's like Charizard all the way to Pikachu, Blastoise, I don't know, the blue one that looks like it punches, whatever it is. Not the one with the four arms, but the one with like the...
Machop? Machamp?
Nah, not that one.
It's Machill?
One of those. What, yes, Justin.
So what, it's the Tekken characters?
No, it doesn't actually look like Tekken. Mm. It looks like you can free run anywhere in 3D.
So it's a parkour
kinda like
game.
Power Stone-esque, except there's no like obstacles. It's just like flat open arenas. That's what it kind of looks like to me.
Honestly, I'm excited for the concept. And I did watch the video. It looks awful.
You really think so?
It looks awful. Like, if you're in a... Like, from just looking at it as a fighting game, it's kind of like... I don't see it. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't... It's kind of like when... It's kind of my issue with Killer Instinct. We were talking about Killer Instinct a few weeks ago. Whenever they do a Killer Instinct demo reel, they always show just how badass one character is and how much you can beat up the other characters. And if you watch Street Fighter demo reels, they always show how people are countering those special attacks. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And Killer Instinct's actually a great fighting game, but with this Pokken thing, I didn't see any actual combat. I saw somebody hitting somebody else, which doesn't really explain how it works, you know?
Sure, sure. But Lucha Libre Pikachu, that's the thing. That is the thing that exists.
Oh, man. I don't trust him ever since he actually killed that guy in the ring 2 months ago.
Yeah, that was bad.
It was.
The announcer quit announcing after that match.
Yeah.
It's never going to be the same.
After Pikachu has murdered somebody, I can't announce this ever again.
Yeah, I mean, fighting games aren't my thing, so I guess I don't have feelings on it one way or the other. I think it's smart, because if there's one thing that sells a lot, regardless of quality, it's
Pokemon.
Yeah.
And this will be the very first time those damn Pokemon have a game out on the Wii U. Good job, Nintendo. Toot toot! Splatoon!
I love it. You love it.
I'm
pointing at Steve. And Justin is aware of it.
I've heard about this.
Well, guess what? Over in Japan, they're having a $1 million. Dr. Evil there for you.
Oh.
Topical film reference.
baby.
Obi baby?
Obi baby.
Oh, yeah. Obi baby over to this esport in Japan. $1 million for a winner of a game? It's true.
So this game's fun? Maybe I should get into this.
Oh, my God. Splatoon is really good.
I could compete for $1 million?
Go get a Wii U. Go. Go right now.
Maybe later.
So okay. are people, it's going to be like team-based? Like people are actually going to like put together Splatoon teams, like Dota teams and shit?
From what I understand, yes. And yeah, that's all we really know about it. It's going to be kicking off soon. There's that Pokemon tournament going on right now as well. And they're even going to have a Puzzle and Dragons tournament. This is being funded by people that own things like Famitsu and Nikovideo. Nikovideo is awesome if you want to see some pirated stuff. That's how I watched Looney Tunes back in action. That's a true story. That movie's pretty good.
I have not seen it.
I saw that one. Is that with Jenna Elfman?
It's the one with Steve Martin as the villain.
Brendan Fraser and Jenna Elfman as the heroes, yeah.
That's pretty good.
It was all right.
I thought it was actually really... It actually is more keeping with the classic characters. Like, Bugs Bunny keeps fucking up and getting hurt.
I thought you were just going to say Bugs Bunny keeps fucking. I'm like, oh, that's why you get
it. That's why Colin likes it.
I hate all these Bugs Bunny cartoons where he just gets away with everything. That's not the Bugs Bunny character. He always gets like makes big mistakes. That's kind of part of the character. He's a wise ass despite his failures. That's what I'm trying to say.
Like Groucho Marx.
That's it, guys. I'm getting out here and going to the WB store. Toot toot! Big Hero 6 is going to be in Kingdom Hearts 3. That's right. San Francisco City is going to be there with Hero and Baymax. I've never seen these movies, but I have played Kingdom Hearts 3, and I assume you guys have all played Kingdom Hearts.
Yeah.
Do you think about do you want to explore this city in Kingdom Hearts? Is that what you want to do?
I don't know. I mean, the movie just takes place in San Francisco, so do I want to explore San Francisco?
Do you want to do that with Mickey and Donald and whatever the hell else they put in there?
I don't know. I mean, I'm not super into Kingdom Hearts, which is probably a thing I shouldn't say in a video game podcast. Here come the angry emails.
Well, I read all the graphic novels.
It's a pretty cool little movie. I liked it.
Yeah.
It was okay. A little overrated. I felt like,
The same could be said for Kingdom Hearts, though, so...
Well, then there's going to be a match made in
heaven. Justin Engelbart.
Hey.
Oh.
But you can't say the same thing about Steve Cuff because he's a magic man.
Hearthstone is getting an update called the Grand Tournament. It is releasing today and will feature 132 new cards. And there's two new modes. Joust, which is going to have each player unveil a card. Whatever is more powerful, the other guy loses. Or you can also create some buffs for your minions whenever you use your hero power. What does this mean? I don't know! Toot toot! Okay, this is a good one. EverQuest 2. It's been around for a bit, to say the least. But that doesn't mean that Daybreak Games isn't continuing to update it. In fact, they've created a brand new server called Drunder. If you cheat in EverQuest 2, you'll be sent to Drunder. What is this server? Just a prison. Just a jail for cheaters.
I really want to meet guy who's cheating at EverQuest 2 in the year of our Lord 2015. Who are you, strange basement-dwelling man?
So wait, when you get sent to the prison, do you just stop playing then? Is there something you can actually do inside of that prison, or are you just like, okay, I'm done?
Whenever you get a quest, it's just like, go over there and think about what you did.
That's going to be, you know, shiv the guy and take his brownie. According to Daybreak Games, ultimately players who break the rules or want to... will have a world of their own to do whatever they will.
So there's a thought police here?
Followed by, let's see where this takes us.
Just like hacking their ways out of the jail? Like, what would you... That's so weird.
I can't wait.
I'd like to see footage of it. I just want to see what it looks like.
But to get there, you'd have to cheat. And I'm no cheater. So I'm not going to make that footage.
Maybe make an honest mistake.
Honest mistake? What about double Jeopardy? You know? And that way you can go
Ashley
back and
Judd?
You can kill your husband in EverQuest 2. Toot toot! Rockstar's video editor, the Rockstar editor, is coming to the PlayStation 4 and Xbox One for Grand Theft Auto 5. It has been a feature on the PC since its initial release and has led to some very boring, awful videos that people on internet forums find hilarious. Not funny.
Everybody's got their audience, right?
Look, I used the mod, so it's monkeys. Toot toot! Is Back to the Future from Telltale Games getting a physical release for the Xbox One or PlayStation 4? If the rumors are right, It is. That's according to NeoGAF. It will be called the 30th Anniversary Edition because of the movies or whatever. Did you ever play these adventure games for Back to the Future?
No. From what I understand, though, it's like it's an early Telltale game, so it's not some of their best work. It's better than like Telltale Jurassic Park, but it's not like, you know, Walking Dead caliber stuff.
Marty! Everybody try it.
Marty!
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 We're turning Doc Brown into like an elderly Jewish woman. Marty, what are you doing?
22 gigawatt.
Come on, Marty, let's go.
Excellent. This is a good part of the show. Toot toot! Super Meat Boy Forever is going to be developed. That's right. Edmund McMuffin, or McMillan, whatever. Doesn't matter to me.
Tomato, tomato.
He had this to say. Super Meat Boy Forever is back in development again and is my primary project at this point now that Afterbirth is basically completed on my end. This guy is proficient as hell. He puts out games all the time. Of course, the Meat Boy, Super Meat Boy, one of the most beloved games, independent games of the last generation. Plenty of YouTube videos just go insane over that title, and rightfully so. It's a skill-based platformer.
Hey, Big Edmund, I know you're listening, so could you hurry up and get Afterbirth out? Because I really, really want to play it really bad.
You already just released a game, and you played it, and we'll talk about that in a minute.
Yeah, I'm gonna talk about
it. Stop being so greedy.
Oh, when I started playing Fingered, it was a totally different thing.
Oh, dear. Toot toot! And lastly, there was a fan remake of Resident Evil 2, looked pretty darn good, and has now been shut down by Capcom. Sorry, Invader Games, but they did provide us with this quote. Not us, but everybody. They didn't say, Colin, say this on the show, but here's what they said. Contrary to what might be thought, this is wonderful news for us. And as fans, we're so happy that Capcom has decided to take the lead of the project and to develop the remake awaited for years by everybody. Nobody could bring back to life the masterpiece of 1998 better than the creators themselves.
I don't know. I had a lot of faith in Invader Games to make the best version of this.
It's just Invader Games. There's no question mark.
They should have released this, like the press release or whatever, as a video. And the person who put out the press release could have been wearing a shirt that said, "We don't do it."
We don't do it.
We don't do it.
We don't do it. Uh-oh. We're getting off the hype train. Oh my god, we gotta come back and talk about the games of the week. We gotta go to the chart park. We gotta talk about strong history and pocket talk. There's still so much more coming on this episode of the Pressure Cast. So please.
Yes.
Stay tuned. Yeah, hold on.
Please.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay, I'm going door to door today. I've got this product to sell.
Right, what is this?
Look, you need these. Every man needs these.
What are these here? These are sharp. What
they're
are
sharp.
These? Yes.
They're sharp enough. Look, watch. It'll cut this apple right open.
Yeah, I definitely did that.
But if you use it on your face, you can make it look nice and sharp and clean.
What are these?
Razor blades.
You're going door to door to sell razor blades, huh?
No one wants to go to the store anymore.
You're right about that, buddy. But I've already found an alternative, another avenue, if you will, to purchase razor blades, and it's called Harry's.com. That's right, Harry's.com. I only spend $3 a month, and they ship it directly to me. I know what you're saying there, buddy. You're saying, oh, they're going to charge you for shipping. They're going to pay you for shipping. What's going to happen? No, no one pays for shipping. Well, Harry's does. They float you the bill there. So for only $3 a month, I get so many razors, and it feels like a brand new shave every time I do it. Face is smooth. So smooth. So much better than your razors or even those store razors. So what did I tell you? How about I get you to Harry's.com and sign you up so that you can get razors, and you don't have to walk around to people's houses and knock on doors.
I've got a lot of razors to sell. I'm going to have to keep going after this.
Oh.
You know, I was even going to charge you shipping.
Yeah, I know. Harry's.com, though, is better.
It does sound like a better deal, but I'm going to have to try to keep my livelihood going here.
Okay, I'm going to have to call my neighbors and tell them about Harry's.com. I'll see you later.
I'll go to a different neighborhood.
Okay, bye. To the show, welcome back. Well, we have come to the point of the show where we talk about the most recent game releases we've been playing.
Woo!
And this, I don't know, games this week, recent releases, whatever you want to call this, games of the week. We got a lot to talk about. We got Volume, Fallout Shelter, Pac-Man 256, Zombie, Black Ops 3, and Fingered. Steve, where would you like to start?
I'd like to start with my finger experience.
Okay.
Real quick, last week we talked about the space shooter game with the weird banjo man on the cover, and we couldn't think of the name of it. What is the name of the Japanese arcade game where there's a butt and you poke it?
I don't know the name of that, but yeah.
We'll find out next week.
We probably will. Get that email going.
You have to use both fingers.
Okay.
That's an actual prank in Japan. That's like totally appropriate.
People just like goose each other in the butt?
Yeah.
That seems really weird.
With two fingers.
All right, I know what I'm going to do if I ever meet Miyamoto.
Oh, God. No, Mr. Miyamoto, run!
Anyways, I played Fingered. It's the new Ed McMillan game. It's kind of a smaller game compared to what
Traitor
he usually
of
makes.
Meat Boy.
He made, yeah, Meat Boy, Isaac, cool stuff.
Meat Boy Man.
And this was his thing. He took about like 6 months off, so he wanted to get back into game development, so he made this like, you know, small game, basically. What you do is, it's kind of like a riff on the board game Guess Who. So you have a police lineup of five or six criminals, and then you have a person giving you a description. Now, sometimes they say things like, I'm sure they, you know, were bald or something like that. If they say that, then you know. And then there's another thing they say where they're like, I think, blah, blah, blah. If they say, I think, that means it's only a 60% chance that it's actually true.
Mm.
So you don't always get surefire things. You kind of have to, you know, figure out in your head, okay, based on this, like, what gives me the highest percentage of getting this one correct? So there's a little bit more logic and thinking behind it. It's pretty cool. The other thing, too, is a lot of the things are subjective. So if she's like, I think he was really ugly. It's like, Ooh. Well, all these character designs are pretty grotesque, so I don't, like, what does ugly mean to this woman?
She ain't no beauty queen herself. I mean, you've been throwing stones.
And then once you decide who you think is the person she's describing, then you finger them. I mean, you know, you point the finger on the, you know,
yes,
on the screen.
Why do they call it fingered then?
Because it's like you fingered someone in a crime. It's like in the film noir version, not what I'm going to do to Miyamoto's butt.
That explains
how much
it.
Does this cost? It's
what is it? $1.87.
So it's $1.87. Got it.
Yeah, $1.87. Super
cheap. I have that here.
It's really fun. Like if it's a good game. Like if you're playing something really intense, like if you just played Bloodborne for 12 hours or something and you just kind of want to like decompress, it's a fun little game to play. I like
it.
Oh,
okay, cool.
And it's a $1.87. Buy it, you assholes. Go buy it.
Okay, I'll go buy it right now. Wow. I recommend fun.
Absolutely. Totally good. Recommend it.
Good. I'm going to check it out. I will. But I've been too busy playing those free-to-play mobile games. Yes, we're talking about actual video games in just a moment. I just want to get this out here real quick. I did get the opportunity to play Fallout Shelter. On the Android device. Let me tell you, that game is addictive. You just build little bases. You build little rooms inside of your vault. You know, this is based off the Fallout series. So the entire wasteland is destroyed from nuclear bombs. So you have to take care of everybody. And you have to, you know, balance how much food they have, how much water they have, and how much electricity they have. So whenever you build a new room, that requires electricity. So you really have to think about what you're doing before you build it. It's like, wait a minute, I should be focusing on building that next electric room. But when you do that, you might also risk everybody getting, you know, cancer. So you have to build a room that's going to give them raid away. And then you also have to build health packs. And then there's raiders that'll just run and start killing people. Then you got to send people out to the wasteland to get those weapons. But they might not come back. It's really addictive.
Let me tell you, I heard you playing this, and it sounded like you were having fun.
I was having a laugh.
I was definitely some joyful tapping, would you say?
Yeah, but you know, you get this. The only problem with the game is that, like any of these titles, it initially starts off very fast. Everything's really cheap, and then sooner or later, you have to wait forever to build up money. And
yeah, you hit the paywalls.
Not really. The paywalls aren't terrible, but like you just have to wait too long. It's not like, oh, you have to come back 24 hours to build this. There's always something to do. Like you always do have to click the button that'll give everybody the water, level up people, you know, swap people out of rooms where they might be better suited in case there's a fire. Keep track of that. You can play the game totally without paying for anything, and it is fun. It's free to play, so I recommend everybody download it. But you know, for me, after about a week, I'm like, I'm okay.
Is it going to usurp, Alpha Bear as my go-to mobile game for riding the bus?
Yes.
It's better than Alpha Bear. Oh my God.
Why not?
I love Alpha Bear.
Although you might want to play, the latest game from the Crossy Road creators. I forget their names already. Whale Hipster.
Hipster Whale.
Hipster Whale, whatever the name is. Pac-Man 256. This is a very strange game. It kind of has that third quarter portrait isometric view similar to that of Crossy Road. What's interesting about it is that it starts off and it just kind of looks like a Pac-Man game. So my first instinct was to go down to avoid a ghost. And then you see all this kill screen data of just eights and ones, and they're all different colors climbing up the screen. It's like, oh my God, this is a Pac-Man style endless runner where you actually have to progressively go up the screen avoiding the ghosts. And while you're doing this, of course, there's power pellets. Obviously. Come on.
What's Pac-Man without power pellets?
Come on. They even had that in Pac-Man 2, The New Adventure. But there's other updates or other powers you can get, such as Laser Beam, where Pac-Man just shoots a laser out of his mouth and kills all the ghosts in front of him. You can freeze the ghosts in place. And also you can have these arrows that are going to slow you down if they're facing the opposite direction, or speed you up if you're going in the same direction as them. It's just an endless runner, but you play as Pac-Man and you just swipe left, right, up, or down to control it. It's a lot of fun. And you can always buy more credits if you want. You can buy upgrades. But then you can always just tap a button where you watch a commercial for something and you get more credits. I love that system. That's my favorite system for a game like that. So I sat through some dumbass commercial so that I could...
What was the commercial for?
I don't know. Something about trees. And I don't know. They were singing. I don't know what it
was. Save our trees.
I hate trees.
I don't know what it was all
about.
I
want to buy a house just so I can kill all the vegetation and pour concrete over it.
Damn right. Okay, and up next, Volume on the PlayStation 4. This is a game from Mike Bithell, the famed creator of Thomas Was Alone. It does look a lot like Metal Gear Solid VR Missions that was on the PS1, and that's essentially what the game is. You go around trying to avoid people while collecting certain items. Once you've collected those items, it activates an area that you have to stand on to go on to the next stage. There are 100 stages. You know, it's got a pretty... interesting story where it turns out you're playing an old simulator that actually it's simulating a number of heists, and those heists take place in royal households, if you will. And the guy that's robbing all these places in the simulation is actually broadcasting that out to the public to show them how to steal from all these rich people and how everybody's looting. But it doesn't make any sense because he's playing on an old simulation that's like literally 8 years old. How would they not? How's that data relevant? And it's not connected to a server at all. They make a really big point about that. So how's that information correct? Also, the voice acting is really bad, real bad, too casual. Also, it's just Metal Gear Solid the VR missions. It's really just that. You've just remade a game from 1998. You added nothing to it.
The hottest of hot takes. It's coming fast and furious.
Well, I'm seeing all these, and I'm not gonna, whoever reviewed those games out there, that's fine. They can, whatever they enjoy. But I played Metal Gear Solid VR Missions. This adds nothing. Whatever it adds is just the smallest amount of stuff. And the worst part is there's really no room for experimentation. It's obvious when you need to use one device or another, whether that's, whistling to get somebody's attention or flinging a noise device. Like when you, I want to reach this guy, or I got across this room, but I can't whistle. Oh, I can't whistle. Oh, I wonder what I have to do. I have to throw that thing. All right, great. Awesome. It's a boring game.
Ooh.
Why would Mike Bithell waste his time recreating something that already exists? It's really just the most obnoxious fan service I've seen in a while. And you know what? Fine. Here's the thing. He's fine to do whatever he wants. He's absolutely A-okay creating this game. If this is an educational or a passion project for him, that's fine. I didn't like the game at all, and I'm blown away by all the positive coverage of this game. It blows me away.
The hottest of hot takes.
I can't help it.
Surface of the sun.
Doesn't
it have like a level editor?
It does.
That's fun. Probably. I haven't played the game.
Sure. I guess. But
You can make your own. Video games are dumb. Those secret missions.
I guess. I don't know. I wouldn't waste your time. The only system it would be good on is Vita, and that's been delayed. We'll get to that later. Because all the stages are like 3 minutes long. It's really just overly stiff, not creative. It's unfortunate. When you don't give as much as you borrow, that's where I'm like, red flag. You know, that's just me though. So Mike Bithell. You can apologize to us at Pressure Cat. No, I'm just kidding. Mike Bithell, you're a good guy. Thomas Is Alone is a fantastic title. Wish you all luck. I hope it sells well just to support him for future projects, but I hope he doesn't take that as, Volume 2 coming out next year. Like, fuck no.
We hope to see your apology soon.
Yes, we'll be waiting. And then there's Zombie, the game that is Zombie U, but not Zombie U.
Mm-hmm.
It is now on the Xbox One. They took the minimap that was on the Wii U gamepad and they put it right on the screen. To scan rooms, you no longer have to use any sort of
Stylus?
No.
No, you just hold the shit up and then hold a button and then you move around you're actually physically moving the tablet controller to look at shit.
What is it, gyrometer? What am I looking
for
here?
Yeah, that's the word.
Now all those controls are just right on the controller. I played on the Xbox One. You just hold out a button and move the analog stick. I haven't died yet in the game. I played it for a while. It's really fun because you just go around, you fight zombies. The zombies are no pushover, so it's very, very tense. You get a bunch of different weapons, and when you die, you are dead for good. You've lost all your stuff. However, you can come back and find yourself as a zombie, kill it, and take your items back. It doesn't look super great, but it's a really cool concept. I had a lot of fun with it, but at least on the Xbox One release, a lot of glitches. Freezing, crashing, not good. So wait for a few updates on that title. I hate to say that. I was having a good time. I'd go into a room, and it'd just go, jik, and I'd wait 2 minutes. It was broken.
Is this the first time you played the game? Did you play the Wii U original extensively?
I thought I had never played the game before, but I believe I did play it maybe 10 minutes of it at a kiosk once.
It was a big kiosk game for a while.
Was it really? Because I couldn't picture myself where it could have been,
Yeah, because Reggie was really pushing the make yourself a zombie.
Oh, yeah.
Function, which is literally the dumbest, gimmickiest thing. And when people always say, the tablet controller is so gimmicky, it's well, in some cases like that. But yeah, all it does is just, it's like a Instagram filter that makes you look like a zombie. It's fucking stupid.
It was, but it's a fun game. Hopefully they'll get a Zombie 2 out that'll be more suited for the current hardware platform.
Super underrated.
Yeah, it was. It was actually really good. But the most important game of the week isn't even out yet. I played the beta for Call of Duty Black Ops 3.
Ooh.
All right, guys, ask away.
Okay. Is this going to change my mind about Call of Duty games and my experiences with them?
Maybe. The thing is that this game is so different. Last year's and this year's titles are so different from what they've done in the past that I can't say if it's going to change my mind on the series overall, but I think this will engage you quite a bit.
More of that Titanfall parkour shit going on?
There is. There's actually double jumps and dash slides. However, unlike Advanced Warfare, I feel like the verticality of the stages is a lot more limited. Mm-hmm. And because of that, it's a little bit more risky to double jump onto a higher ledge or across a gap. Or wall run or anything like that. And because of that, even though you're in more control, it essentially turns that the double jump into a ladder, like climbing a ladder, where you're kind of defenseless because you have to be focusing on the platform that you're jumping to. So if someone's behind you, they could totally kill you. So I really like that. They balanced out the double jumps a lot more. And the dash slides are cool because you can just slide it right in and melee someone right in the face, get the nose breaker. Oh, I love that. It's really fun to have just all these different abilities in this game, though, beyond just the jump and dash slide, because there are now 9 classes that you pick from before you start the match. Now, if you've never played a Call of Duty, you actually just pick your weapons and you pick your perks and you pick your...
it's like your loadout or whatever.
Yeah, that's how it basically created that on popular games. But this time around, there are 9 different selectable classes, and each of them have 2 different power-ups that you must select one, from there. I can't talk. Man, every time we do this fucking segment, I just turn into a piece of shit. God damn it.
You are a beautiful piece of shit.
I talk like crap. Crap.
You need to listen to the Christina Aguilera song.
Okay.
Maybe it's because we're talking about duty.
this guy here.
So what happens is when you pick from these classes, you pick one of those abilities. The one that I played as during the first hour that I did of it, you could hold down the button. You level it up. Like, it progresses while you kill people.
Which button?
You have to press L1 and R1. While it builds up from kills or survival or whatever you're doing, because you get points for basically everything. And once you activate it, for this example, it would create this beacon, and you could see everybody through the walls. There'd be a red outline around them. And so I'd know where they were. And Call of Duty has a lot of walls that you can shoot through. So that gave me a huge advantage. Mm-hmm. There's also a bow and arrow that you just launch at somebody and it'll blow them up and anyone around them. Very basic functionality. But it also, I believe, is silenced. So that really helps because people can't see you on the minimap. One of them allows you to come back from the dead. It's really weird. They kind of teleport or something. It's very, very strange. So you have to kill the people twice, which I had no problem doing because I'm great at the game. one of them, you just jump in the air and you just slam into the ground. It's a lot like that Destiny attack. That one's not as cool. But one of my favorite ones, I didn't use it, but I saw a lot, was this lightning gun. You would shoot somebody, and they'd be standing there going like, you know. And
like a taser, maybe.
And then it would connect to a different player.
Oh.
But it takes about 1 second to do, but it has a pretty wide range. So when you walk into a room and you see somebody like shaking for electricity, it's like, oh, shit, I got to get out of here.
That's like the lightning weapons in Nuclear Throne. Do that.
Oh,
I wonder
okay.
if that's where they got the inspiration from.
Maybe. But this is a Black Ops title, which is awesome because Black Ops has the best loadout system of any of the Call of Duty series. The way that it works, I guess you need some sort of comparison, maybe almost like Resident Evil 4 in a way. It's not about the size of your items, though. Every item has value, from weapons to attachments to grenades to perks. So you actually decide what's most valuable to you. For instance, I found 3 attachments I really liked. And I was carrying 2 concussion grenades. I'm like, whatever. So I got rid of those grenades so that I could have more attachments. As long as it doesn't go over, you can use it. Much like The Price is Right, if you will. And it's just really fun to be able to say, like, you know what? I don't need any perks because I just want to make my main gun super powerful. Or I want to have all of these perks and I want to have all these grenades, but I don't need a sidearm. It really allows you to customize. The better that you do, the more points you get. Those points add up to like, you know, 1, 2, or 3 points. You're not going to carry like 400 points on you.
Mm-hmm.
And from there, you can just purchase upgrades one by one and then add it into your arsenal. It's so much fun. It's like the amount of customization is ridiculous. And it's really the best in the series. And I'm so excited all of a sudden because now with these 9 different classes, this customizable system, and the way that you can double jump and dash slide, it is... I don't know how else to say it. It's a fantastic first-person shooter. And it still has the classic, as I would say, online paintball feel. And obviously, you got your shotgun, sniper rifles, and blah, 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 blah.
And the beta is multiplayer only, right? So you
and only available on the PlayStation 4.
Okay.
So if you're on Xbox One, you're jackass. Also worth noting, this is going to be the very first year that this is going to be a marketing exclusive with Sony, as well as all the map packs are going to be coming to the PlayStation 4 first. I think if you've never played a Call of Duty title, this is a great one to jump into because I know some people are actually intimidated by Call of Duty, which is...
Me.
Is that right? I honestly find that so funny because it is the most inviting game ever. That's like being intimidated by... I don't know, going to Leaps and Bounds or Chuck E. Cheese.
Colin, I don't like teens doing swears.
Oh.
So wait, if I haven't played any of the earlier ones, am I going to be missing out on anything?
You're going to be missing out on a lot. You're not going to understand anything. There's just going to be lights and
color.
Why am I fighting?
I think my dislike of Call of Duty, I mean, I don't like the obnoxious people that tend to be in online matches. That's part of it. But the other thing is at this point, it's the same reason why I don't like a lot of anime, and we've talked about this, I don't know, on the show, but definitely off the show, where, you know, a lot of these anime shows, they have like 500 episodes, and it's just like, when I play a Call of Duty game, I feel like I'm on episode 384 of an anime, and I have no clue what's going on, and I'm way behind, and everybody else around me knows way more than I do.
Yeah, but... I understand that. I understand that feeling. But, you know, it's kind of like, you know, if me and Justin go and get tacos every single week.
Every week.
After the show. Me and after him always show. Get the tacos. And we go to this taco place every single week. And sooner or later, you're kind of like, all right, I'll come along with you guys. And you join us.
Mm-hmm.
You're in on the action. You might be saying, what the hell are you talking about tacos and or something like that? But Call of Duty is a foundation. It's never going away now.
Mm-hmm.
It's permanent. No matter whether the sales go up or down, it's never going away. NHL... the games, they're never going away either. This is permanent shit now. And so it's all about just joining in on the conversation. The reason you want to play the next year's game is because you're joining up with all your familiar friends. You're going back to the same restaurant.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, you know, they change it up a little bit. Maybe they had Christmas lights around December and put some American flags around July, but it's the same basic game.
Sure.
Maybe they add a new dish on the menu, but it's always fun to go back to that same restaurant with your friends every single year. It's diverse enough.
Okay,
you know,
sure,
except for Call of Duty Ghosts, which is awful.
I can see that. Like, if you guys are both playing, I would go online to play with
can
you.
Can I play
I
with you
I'd
guys?
Have more fun with friends.
So, yeah, Steve, let's play together.
Can
let's
I play with you guys, though? Can I get in on this game with
I
you?
Mean, that's how I feel about Black Ops 3.
Borderlands 3?
PS4. I don't know. I would recommend everybody go out and get it. If you get a PlayStation 4 and,
talking to me.
And Call of Duty, Steve.
Oh, come on, guys. You should.
Steve, we will play online together.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Should
have gone to Walmart with me, Justin.
I'm going to go to the
Walmart and tell him about what happened 2 weeks ago.
Yeah, I'll tell him about that at Walmart.
Fantastic. I don't know. I really love it. I can't wait to play more of it. I love Call of Duty, though, and I understand that's not...
Are you just saying this on the show?
No, I love Call of Duty. In the video, the way I explained it at the end was, I was like... My favorite...
Are you just saying this for the show?
I said it on the video. I was like, my favorite game of last year, Bayonetta 2, love my JRPGs, like my indie titles, love puzzle games. I love Call of Duty. You know, I think that there's a stigma attached to Call of Duty, rightfully so, because there is just a... I think it was more to do with Xbox Live, all the disgusting homophobia and racism. Mm-hmm. But the games themselves are so much fun. And yeah, you know, it is like going to the same restaurant because, yeah, you're going to get sick of that. But sooner or later, you're going to get a hankering for killing somebody. And that's when you go to Call of Duty. Mm-hmm. Or, you know.
Killing's on the menu.
Okay. Great. All right. Let's pretend to go outside. It's time for the Char Park.
Hey,
the land where
this.
Money grows on trees.
So much sunshine.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
There used to be trees. Now there's just cement.
We're just pretending to do things outside.
It's a concrete jungle, baby.
Hey,
I you know, guys, I can't pretend this week. I can't pretend we're going to the Char Park. So I guess we're just going to have to go to the Char Park. The land where money grows on trees. Yes, the Char Park. This is the part of the show where we discuss all the financial, business, and legal news in the video game industry. And we find out which fat cats of Wall Street will tip their top hats towards Lady Luck. Starting off with Clint Hocking. You might remember him from Far Cry 2. And if you don't, Clint Hocking is from Far Cry 2. And then he went to Amazon Game Studios. Apparently, he has exited the studio. And we never saw a game come from him. Why we not see no game come from him?
Where is he going?
Who knows?
I can't say that I'm surprised. Like, did you read that article? I want to say it was in, like, Vanity Fair or something.
Oh, that old thing?
Yeah, like, it's just like Amazon has, like, gulag-esque work conditions.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's not good.
Didn't sound great. No. Didn't sound like very promising. But he's also now alone. Jonathan Hamill and Eric Newland have also left without actually releasing a game. Eric was part of narrative design. Jonathan was part of principal game design. Kim Swift is still there, the co-creator of Portal and Quantum Conundrum. So who knows what the hell's going on? Is Amazon going to back away from in-house development of games? I mean, did they release anything yet?
I don't know. I mean, I know you can play games on, like, the Fire Stick and the Fire Roku or whatever the hell it's called.
Fire Stick.
I've never tried it. I would assume there's shit on there, but yeah. I mean, just like there's Ouya games. You know they exist, but have you ever seen them? If
not
an Ouya falls in the forest.
And no one's there to actually buy an Ouya. Well, we already know what happened to Ouya. Not only that, but Amazon is abandoning all other markets except for the United States when it comes to trade-ins. Now, you can't trade your games in if you're in Germany or the UK or France.
I wonder why that is. Is it just not profitable for them?
Who knows? But that will be ending starting September. No, August 31st. That's when they're stopping.
You still got Gary Busey over there?
Gary Busey.
Spokesperson?
This is not what Gary Busey sounds like.
I like playing my games on the Fire Stick.
Is that what he sounds like? I want to hear more. Tell me more, Gary.
They're a lot of fun when you talk to them.
Are you like an oil tycoon? What are you?
I can't do it. It's tough to do a Gary Busey. I want to hear yours, Steve.
You sound more like Foghorn Leghorn.
Well,
I said, play the games on the Fire Stick.
That would be a better spokesperson, probably, right?
Sony has detailed their plans for the Paris Games Week. They will have a press conference on Tuesday, October 27th. That's Paris time. Who knows when that actually is.
Probably like Wednesday.
Well, Paris fans of football, as they call it, will have their own version of Gamescom, essentially, which is important because Sony wasn't at Gamescom, and you could honestly say that Microsoft ran in there, made a touchdown, spiked the ball, and did a little funky dance. So hopefully Sony can bring the fire this time. They need to. I don't know.
Sony Fire?
Stick. Gamefly has a game streaming service. This is true. And now it's expanded to Samsung televisions in the United States, Canada, and a bunch of other European regions. According to David Hodes, he's the CEO of Gamefly, Samsung's global reach is a great way to bring Gamefly streaming to consumers across the globe. The service itself is kind of confusing. Like, there are different bundles that you pay for. You don't actually pay for a singular service. It's kind of like, Darksiders 2 and Batman, anybody? That's on a service together for some reason.
That's weird.
Do you just want to play some Lego games?
the Lego game service for $9.99 a month. Well, they put out probably like one or two a month, right?
Pretty much. As long as you have an Xbox wired controller or a couple of Logitech controllers, you can do this. Is this necessary, Gamefly? What do you guys say?
It's smart. I think it's brilliant.
Really?
Yeah, I think that this is the future. If you want to know, game consoles will cease to exist in a decade, and this is what will happen.
That's absolutely right.
But so Gamefly might as well get in on the ground floor, because then in 10 years, one of the big companies can just buy them out.
I'm just not convinced that streaming through Wi-Fi onto a television is going to get you the best results, you know?
No, that's the other thing, too, is the infrastructure's not quite there yet, I think, for a lot of people, which is why my OnLive t-shirt that I own is a bit of a, you know, collector's item.
America's internet sucks.
It does.
It's awful. It's truly awful. Now, if this was South Korea, I'd say, whatever, baby, let's go do this, stream the games. I'm cool with that. But here? Hell no.
Yeah, it's gonna take a while before the infrastructure can support it. But once the infrastructure can support it, or they can figure out something on the server side to like compress the files down enough, then yeah.
Excellent. Gearbox officially owns the Duke Nukem rights. This was a long, long time coming after they had a major dispute with 3D Realms. For some reason, 3D Realms thought they still owned it, even though they sold them the rights to Duke Nukem.
I just can't believe that people want it. Like, why would anyone want that?
Well, Mike Nelson, the CEO of 3D Realms, had this to say. To secure the future of Duke, 3D Realms has agreed with Gearbox that a single home serves the IP best. And as big Duke fans, we're excited to see what Gearbox has in store for the King. As for our own games, we're eager to complete development for the Bombshell game and get it in the hands of our fans. Jesus Christ.
What fans?
Damage control.
What? Yeah. Your fans were me when I was 12. Not anymore.
I still love Duke Nukem 3D. That is an amazing game.
It's fun, but Duke Nukem Forever is a colossal abomination, yeah. Obviously. I don't know. There's very little value. I would say right now Duke Nukem might have negative value. Like... I can't imagine it's just, the last game was so bad, it's kind of an outdated character, and it's not self-aware enough to be interesting. It's bizarre to me. It's like, if I took a shit on the floor and you and Justin went to court to see who owned it, like, why would you want to do that?
Well, I mean, Justin, I mean, it's mine, obviously, so.
You can have it. I'm going to go for Leader Suit Larry instead.
Fantastic. John Smedley! Remember him? He had that whole beef with Lizard Squad, and then they did a lot of stuff to his company, Daybreak Games.
And they ruined his life.
They basically did. He stepped down from his position, and officially now, this week, has left the company completely. He was there for nearly 20 years, which is very sad. He talked out against Lizard Squad. They were hacking the games. They were hacking his personal information, which they had already done. So when he took to Twitter and said he was going to come and get him, they found him first. Sorry, buddy. Cast AR! That's right. Cast AR, which is an augmented reality headset, has now raised over $15 million thanks to Playground Global. According to Cast AR CEO David Henkel Wallace, among all the confusion about what separates AR from VR, what's lost... is fun. People want a simple, accessible, fun solution that they can just pick up and play with their friends without dealing with a bulky, uncomfortable headset, much less being tethered to a big computer.
He sounds like he knows what he's talking about.
He does. Augmented reality, I'm actually more excited for than virtual reality.
It's
personally.
Just like, it's what you can do with your 3DS, basically, right? Like that stupid pack-in game where like your face gets slanted on the little... like, I don't know, things that fly in the air and you gotta like shoot them.
It's not gimmicky.
Or what's that game where this is another game this week that I can't think of the name of.
The PS3 game?
No, it's a 3DS game, but it's like there's ghosts and shit, and you like actually hold up the 3DS to like scan the room for ghosts, and you actually like find ghosts in your house.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
It's called like Ghost Something.
Yeah.
Ghost Book.
Runaway Ghosts. Actually, it might be Ghost Book or something like that. It's like Book of Ghosts or something.
I don't fucking know. The point is it's, I don't know, like what? And the fact that, oh, it's fun and accessible. If you're putting out a piece of tech that will undoubtedly cost hundreds of dollars, that no longer makes it accessible.
Well, yeah, and besides that, at this point, development on AR or VR is going to be prohibitively expensive, and to the point where that the average consumer will never even give it a chance, because even if they like it, mm-hmm. they don't even want to... People don't like stuff they can't afford.
Yeah.
They just don't. Yeah, people that pretend to like stuff they can't afford are weirdos, and usually they actually don't pay for their own drinks at the club, and then you gotta drive them home. Jesus. Awful.
It's nice to have a designated driver.
Sounds like my night.
Yes. Good news from Rockstar Games. Grand Theft Auto, the entire series, has surpassed 220 million in sales, and Red Dead Redemption has reached 14 million copies sold.
Cool. Put it on PC, please.
Hey, please. Let's go to England and find out what are the best-selling games over in the UK.
Crumpet Simulator.
I don't know. Would you guys ever live in the UK just to play games?
I would.
Just to play games.
Just to play games. You know what I mean?
Like, I want to go watch Crystal Palace play soccer.
Is that a real thing?
That's one of the teams.
Oh, I don't know.
They named it. See, that's the difference between the UK and America. We would never have a team called Crystal Palace.
They just call them Palace.
Why do they just call them Palace?
Because it shortens it.
What?
Otherwise, they have to say both words.
He's got a point, Colin.
I would never name a team Palace.
What would you name your team, Colin?
I would name it the 10 best-selling games in the UK according to the Ookie Game Charts. Number 10 is Dying Light. Number 9 is Minecraft PlayStation Edition. Number 8 is Minecraft Xbox Edition. Number 7 is Battlefield Hardline. Number 6 is Rare Replay, which was previously first place last week. Number 5 is FIFA 15. Number 4 is Batman Arkham Knight. Number 3 is The Elder Scrolls Online. Number 2 is Grand Theft Auto 5. And number 1 is Lego Jurassic World. I hate that fucking game.
Yeah.
What about over in the cursed land of trains known as Japan? Here are the 10 best-selling games. Number 10 is Cho Tsuchu Atsumare. Number 9 is Pokemon Omega Ruby / Alpha Sapphire. Number 8 is Sengoku Barasa 4 Sumerigari. Number 7 is the Blaze Fire Emblem Fates. Or if, whatever you want to call it. Number 6 is Minecraft PlayStation Vita Edition. Number 5 is Mario Kart 8. Number 4 is Rhythm Heaven The Best Plus. Number 3 is Splatoon. Number 2 is Yo-Kai Watch Busters.
Yeah!
Red Cat Team. White Dog Squad. And number 1 is Animal Crossing Happy Home Designer. But what are the best systems, you're asking me right now?
Colin, what are the best systems?
Thank you. Well, let's go through them. New Nintendo 3DS XL with 34,972, Wii U with 19,259, PlayStation 4 with 17,420, PlayStation Vita with 15,825, new Nintendo 3DS with 600,790, PlayStation 3 with 3,040, new Nintendo 3DS with 2,244, Nintendo 3DS XL with 1,039, PlayStation Vita TV with 498, and in last place, Xbox One with 208.
Woo!
And that's gonna do it for the Chart Park, the land where money grows on trees.
Bye bye, Chart Park.
Doot doot.
Well, then, we've certainly had a lot of talking on the show. We talked about games. We talked about sales figures. And up next, we're going to be talking about mobile. We're going to be talking about the idiot of the week. And we're going to be talking about strong history. And we'll do all of that right after this. Hey, Steve.
Hey there, Colin.
What's going on?
Well, Colin, I've been on a 9-day alcohol bender.
Mm-hmm.
And I've just woken up from a drunken haze and realized... I haven't shaved in weeks.
Oh, wow. Wow, wow, wow. That sucks, man. Well, I guess you're going to have to go over to, that local convenience store and beg and plead with the lady behind the counter to take 2 seconds out of her day to open up the case and sell you some overpriced junk razors.
I know, and I spent all of my money on Seagram Seabreeze wine coolers.
So I
can't afford these things. What am I going to do? I can't afford the razors. I can't afford to spend time waiting for that lady to open it up with the little key and then it buzzes when she opens it. She's like, oh, I don't know why it does that. It's not supposed to.
Well, relax, Bartle and James, because I have good news for you. Harry's.com. That's right, Harry's.com. You go there, you tell mom off and you shave, and then for $3 bucks a month, you're going to get razors delivered right to your door. How much is shipping? I'm glad you asked. It's free. You don't pay for shipping. You just pay $3 a month. And how about these razors? Top quality razors. Better than the razors you get behind the counter. They're junk. And besides that, you get razors so frequently, it's like a fresh shave every single time. It's so nice. That means you avoid the razor burn. You keep yourself nice and smooth. And you don't have to go to the stupid convenience store and deal with that dumb lady behind the counter. Just give me the razors already. That is Harry's.com. So now, rejoice, Steve. You don't have to worry about going there anymore.
Colin, you've saved my life. And to show my appreciation, after I go to Harry's.com and they send me my razors, with free shipping, mind you, I think I'm going to shave your initials into my back to immortalize you forever.
Thank you. It's time for Big Talk in a Small World. It's Pocket Talk.
Mushroom noise.
We'll do that after. Final Fantasy VII has come to iOS devices for $20. It is not available on Android devices yet. $20 for Final Fantasy VII. Too much, too little? What say you?
Way too much.
Really?
Yeah.
It's a really long game.
I don't care.
Oh.
Are we gonna charge games by the hour now?
Yeah.
That's a terrible price. Square is disgusting. You are a disgusting company. That's a disgusting price for an old ass game that I can play in a million different ways. Also, side note, they're releasing the Final Fantasy VIII card game as a standalone mobile title. And it's got a free-to-play model that is abhorrent. It is just disgusting.
I mean, what is it, like $3 per card?
Something like that. It's abysmal.
Well, as someone who's paid off by Square Enix to give them 10s out of 10s, as all people who review games, that's what happens there. I say this is a great value and a must-play title for any iOS owner.
For anyone who doesn't like money and hasn't played a game that everybody played.
Nintendo has cut the price of the 2DS permanently. It is now only $99.99 and comes with a copy of Mario Kart 7. So, that's not a bad deal right there. 2DS, of course, is a 3DS, but it does not have the 3D, and it is not a clamshell device. It's more like a doorstop, you know, kind of design there.
Kids really like it. Little kids.
Yeah, but those kids are dumb because it's not a new Nintendo 3DS, so it doesn't have the extra nub.
Doesn't have the nub or the one game.
Yep. Two games.
Ooh, hey, my bad.
Hey, man, it's very easy to keep track of them, so.
I'm still pissed about that. The one game I care about, and it doesn't work on my 3DS.
No. So, Yo-Kai Watch is coming to the United States on November 6th.
Ooh, what Dark Red? Squad yeah, team? Right. Red Ghost.
What Dark Squad? This is going to be an exciting game. It's kind of like Pokemon, but you capture ghosts and you put them in your watch, and all the ghosts have different abilities. It looks like a ton of fun.
What Dog Squad is it?
What Dog Squad? Moving over, do you have a 3DS? Do you have the YouTube app? Yes, yes you do. But more importantly, you can now use that YouTube app to crack your system to play homebrew software and lots of piracy stuff.
Just as this very podcast predicted.
Yes, but they can always update the YouTube app, can't they?
Yeah,
they just could. Have to not update your system then.
Yeah, that's pretty simple. Or just wait for the same person to crack it again, because obviously it doesn't take him very long. We were just talking about this last week.
That's true. Volume is a game that I don't really care for, but it is coming to the Vita, and that will be released in a couple of weeks. According to Mike Bithell, it's so very nearly ready. God, that's British. But it needs a little more love. A few personal problems and issues have slowed down our submittal, so even though the game is quote-unquote done on quote-unquote Vita, we still have some quote-unquote Q&A process to quote-unquote stuff to go through.
That was very British.
Yes.
I'm so very sorry.
Monster Strike. Yes, Monster Strike from the mobile Japanese studio Mixies is apparently bringing in $4.2 million a day. Last quarter, they saw $378 million of revenue.
Jesus.
On this game. Holy crap. Monster Strike. Be there. And that's going to do it for Pocket Talk. We'll take the mushroom now.
That was the worst one yet.
Oh, man.
I love it. It's my favorite thing.
Yeah.
You know what, Colin? You're going to keep trying. Because what do we do when we fall down, Colin?
We stay stupid.
That's right.
Because it's time for the idiot do of the week.
Is that still your mushroom noise?
Oh my god, let's talk about it right now. This actually is barely related to video games, but it's kind of why it's so stupid. Red Ash was the game that's supposed to be the spiritual successor to Mega Man Legends. This is the second time they've been the idiot of the week, by the way. They failed to reach their goal on Kickstarter, announced that they had partnered with some random Chinese company, okay? But they were also making an anime that they were going to fund through Kickstarter. That anime was fully funded on Kickstarter. Now the game is going to be published by and funded by this Chinese developer. Everything worked out. I guess not. Because despite making $163,000 on Kickstarter to produce this short anime, they've returned for crowdfunding of an additional $127,000 because they want to make a 30-minute anime piece for this game.
Who is giving them money? What? Stop
That's
giving
what
them
I,
money.
Who are you,
Otaku.
People? Where are you?
Otaku.
Is that one guy?
Honestly, if a week from now they announced that they were going to start a Kickstarter campaign for a Kickstarter,
yeah,
would you be surprised?
No. I mean, at this point, I don't understand what's going on with this. They solved everything. The anime was funded, and now the game is getting published by somebody else. And now they're going back and saying, well, yeah, but for this game, we really want a 30-minute anime instead of a 12-minute anime.
Give us more money.
Now, and you might be saying, hold on. What does this exactly have to do with video games? I'm sorry, but you look at the relationship they already had with that game, and now you're seeing what they're doing over here. It's not going to stop with the anime. This development isn't just troubled. It's borderline. I don't know. I don't want to say
life support.
I don't want to say. It's beyond troubled. I was gonna say something else. It's a goddamn mess, though. That's for sure. So for trying to get more money for an anime short for your game that didn't even reach its Kickstarter goal, Red Ash, you are once again the idiot. Of the week. We just need on an extra $127,000 to make an anime about this game no one wants.
Actually, now we want to make a serial too.
Yeah. Everything they do, it's a Kickstarter.
Everything we do is a classic.
Yo, fund my Indiegogo campaign. Want to buy a pizza from Pizza Hut? Stuff crust, $12. I take checks.
Maybe perks. We offer perks.
Okay, guys. guys.
We're launching our rap career, Colin.
This has been a truly wonderful episode, but we have to wrap it up by looking back to the past for a segment we like to call Strong History, where we look back at what happened 10 years ago and above, and it is quite the week, gentlemen. 10 years ago this week, The Incredible Hulk Ultimate Destruction was released. I love that game. On the Xbox, PlayStation 2, and GameCube. Great game. It's the only game I can think of where you destroy stuff, and the cops come after you, and then you just destroy the cops to the point where they can't come after you anymore. They're like, oh, God, shut it down. Stop attacking them.
It's a really fantastic game. I love that game so
only
much.
Only solution is to send them into outer space.
That is true. But then they'll be back, and they'll have an army with them. And then Red Hulk. You don't want to get into that.
Red Hulk.
12 years ago, this week, F-Zero GX was released on the GameCube, the Sega-produced racing game based on the Nintendo property.
Wow. I love that game, actually.
It's
I might
so
be the only
hard.
One.
It's so, so hard.
I got really good at it.
You gotta take the joystick and push it forward and then slightly nudge is what I've learned.
Well, I
think
the secret to that game was you just have to destroy all the other cars. Don't even try to win the races.
Like Destruction Derby?
Basically, that's what I ended up doing.
12 years ago, also, Otogi, Myth of Demons, was released on the original Xbox. One of the most interesting Xbox exclusives. I highly recommend everyone check out Otogi, Myth of Demons. And you want to feel kind of old, 12 years ago this week, Soul Calibur 2 was released on the Xbox, PlayStation 2, and GameCube, each with their own characters, including Spawn, Link, and Hayashi Mishimori from Tekken.
Which was kind of stupid.
That was really lame.
That's kind of, yeah.
I don't have weapons. Fantastic. 13 years ago this week, SOCOM U.S. Navy SEALs was released on PlayStation 2, one of my all-time favorite online games.
I wasted so much of my juvenile life playing SOCOM 1 and 2.
But also, Super Monkey Ball 2 was released, the better single-player but inferior multiplayer in my IMO. And the awful Super Mario Sunshine.
Got a hater over here. You don't like Mario with a water gun?
Mafia on the PC. And Onimusha 2, Samurai's Destiny. I love Onimusha 2.
Why aren't they doing... I mean, if they want to just like rehash old shit, like why not make an Onimusha Collection HD?
That's on my list.
Like that would sell pretty well, I would imagine.
I have a list for Shepherd that is going up one of these weeks when I can't write anything. And that's
and now I'm going to claim plagiarism, so good job.
Oh, damn it. 14 years ago this week, Mario Kart Super Circuit was released on the Game Boy Advance.
Classic.
Okay. 15 years ago this week, Power Stone 2 hit the Dreamcast. Mario Kart Tennis was on the Nintendo 64.
Mario Kart Tennis?
Yeah, it's a
Mario
crossover
tennis.
Franchise.
Valkyrie Profile on the PlayStation.
That's a good game.
And Mario Artist Polygon Studio on the Nintendo 64 DD.
I was going to say, is that like one of the five DD games? Like there were three of those, weren't there?
It was, yeah. Well, I think there were actually 11. I can't remember.
But I mean, like three of the Art Studio games, right?
No, no, no. 11 different 64 DD games.
But how many were... there was like a red one, a blue one, and a white one, right? The Art Studio games?
Why does it got to be white?
I don't know.
Why does it got to be red?
Because white Squad Dog Red.
White Squad Dog! 18 years ago this week, GoldenEye 007 on the Nintendo 64, which strangely enough was released in Japan 2 days beforehand, so it premiered in Japan.
You know what
that
means,
makes no sense.
That means that GoldenEye is officially legal.
All right, let's buy GoldenEye some porn.
License to thrill.
Yeah.
19 years ago this week, Tekken 2 hit the PlayStation. Whew. That game is incredible. I always felt like Tekken 3 was the better game, but it lost some of the Tekken-ness, you know, that Tekken 2 had. Fantastic title. 21 years ago this week, the sequel, Echo, The Tides of Time. The sequel to Echo the Dolphin. And some other game called Earthbound was released in Japan.
My favorite game.
Mother 2.
Ah.
Yeah?
Ah.
You like that?
Yeah, I got the Mother 3 cartridge actually on for GBA.
You're so goddamn quiet. Speak.
I have the Mother 3 cartridge for GBA. I've been meaning to play it.
Okay, great. All right, great. 22 years ago this week, Nintendo announced a partnership with Silicon Graphics to create a 3D arcade and console that would be later known as the Nintendo 64. 25 years ago this week, Michael Jackson's Moonwalker was released on the Genesis.
Hell yeah.
I love that game. Not ironically at all. That game is fun.
That game's fun to play.
26 years ago this week, TurboGrafx-16 released in the United States. One of my favorite systems.
I love it.
I love Bonk. I like the sequel to Bonk. The first Bonk's not that great, but the sequel where you have orange juice waterfalls.
Is that Bonk's Revenge? Or is that Bonk's Adventure?
Bonk's Regret? That's the third one.
Bonk's Regret. Bonk. Air Zonk. That's the one that's like the side-scrolling shooter. That game is really fun. Yeah, I love my TurboGrafx. The only thing I don't love about it is it's difficult to find the games like out in the wild, and when you do, they're always super expensive.
You can get one of those cards that you can program.
Oh, can
that,
you?
It's actually...
And it actually goes into the console?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Cool.
You can get a reader and everything. It's Nifty. Awesome. Allegedly. 29 years ago, I Am a Teacher, Super Mario No Sweater was released on the Famicom in Japan.
Yeah, fuck sweaters.
Well, you don't remember this? When Mario teaches you how to make sweaters on the Famicom from 1986? This is real. Yeah.
It kicked off the whole knitting simulator, empire that we know and love today.
You can create designing sweaters with such characters as Mario, Luigi, Peach, and Bowser. And it was devised by Royal Industries. It only cost $24.
Bowser's the enemy. You don't want to promote him.
33 years ago, Ultima 2, The Revenge of the Enchantress was released on the PC.
Oh, damn.
And lastly, 62 years ago, this week, August 24th, 1953, Taito Corporation was founded. And that's insane.
What did they start making? Were they a toy manufacturer like Nintendo?
They created vending machines.
Oh, okay. That makes sense.
And then Taito, of course, would go on to release Space Invaders, which, you know, kicked off Japan into video games like nothing else. So, happy 62nd birthday, Taito
Corporation.
And they did Bubble Bobble, right? Is that them?
Yeah, Justin, they did Bubble Bobble.
And the second one, Rainbow.
Every time Bubble Islands. Bobble comes up, you gotta talk about
my Bibble ears Bobble. Perk about
Bibble Bobble.
Bibs.
Bibble Bobble. Steve, where can people reach you on the internet?
Oh, Jesus, I almost threw up in my mouth.
I know the show's been pretty bad.
No, this... you just scared me. I had a rough night.
All right, well, let's
okay, you can find me at optimismvaccine.com if you like cool articles about cool stuff, pop culture, weird shit, all kinds of bizarre stuff, video games, we do it all. You can go to Shepherd Express every single week at shepherdexpress.com. You can read the Optimism Vaccine column. It's great. It's awesome. This week, I'm actually doing a revised version of an ET article I wrote last year. So, because you didn't read that the first time, you dicks, now you can, I'm going to force it down your throat.
If you haven't read it, it's new to you.
It's new to you. You can find me on YouTube. Channel name is Optimism Vaccine. Of course, you can find me on Twitter at Steve Cuff. That's at Steve. See you, friendly face.
C-U-F-F.
Oh, yeah. Okay, that's at Steve Cuff. C-U-F-F.
See you, friendly face.
There we go. Now we did it. We're getting way better at this.
We did it, guys.
Justin, where is that it?
I think that's all my shit, right?
OpVacCast on iTunes.
Oh, yeah, the OpVacCast. Go on iTunes. I host a podcast. It's fucking great. Why aren't you listening to it?
You can also watch it on your YouTubes.
Yeah, it's got it on the YouTubes.
Justin, where can people reach you on the internet?
I'm at Justin Engelbart on Twitter. I'm also at Justin Engelbart somewhere else online. I can't remember which one.
Can you state your first name for the record, sir? You're on trial.
Justin Engelbart is my name. E-N-G-E-L-B-A-R-T.
He's Justin Engelbart on his birth certificate.
I feel like I could get everything you said on this episode into his single tweet.
I had a quiet episode?
You were very quiet.
Well, that's because you guys are so good.
You should talk. No. We all want to... The I don't know if you know this, but the listeners like you.
No, I don't think they do.
That one guy really didn't like you.
I don't think they do. Someone hates him?
There was one guy that really didn't like him.
Well, that was a week where there were certain things that happened, circumstances that made me unlikable.
Yeah, that's true.
We maybe don't want to revisit
that. You like more so than usual?
Well, tweet at Justin and let him know how great he is.
I've also got a new video series with Colin Tanner. I call it...
It's Justin's show. I'm on it. It's your show.
It's called Justin and Colin Are the Game Players.
Yes.
You can look it up on YouTube.
All right. But definitely check that out.
Don't worry. It's my show.
Okay, great. You can reach me online at Dr. Cryochop on Twitter, at Dr. Cryochop. That's how you get it. You can also follow the PressureCast at PressureCastPod. You can go to youtube.com/games. I almost said an old URL from like a year ago.
Yeah, I noticed that. That was good.
Yeah, so I'm having a stroke.
You gotta do the Pee Wee Herman thing where if you accidentally say the old website name, we all have to scream.
I'm not gonna say it. You can go to youtube.com/videogamesaredumb. That's right, video games are dumb. There's so many fucking games coming out. I can't keep track of it all. Until Dawn, Gears of War, Madden, One Piece. I'm going to be doing a ton of videos this week, so hurry up and watch all of them. They're going to be super, super great stuff. Super great stuff. But that's going to do it for this episode. Steve, thank you for being on the show.
Hey, thanks as always, Con.
Justin, thank you for being here.
You're very welcome, my friend.
That's excellent. Well, of course, we are all going to die some point. Who knows if it's from nuclear bombs or from bird attacks. But remember, regardless, the Pressure Cast will not die because the Pressure Cast is forever. PressureCast, weekly video game news podcast, is solely owned and operated by Colin Tanner. Guests of the PressureCast are not employees or freelancers of Colin Tanner, the PressureCast, or VideoGamesAreDumb.com, and are not paid. Music featured on the PressureCast is property of their respective owners, and no infringement is intended. For more information, email PressureCast@gmail.com.